Well, ISIS is on the move, ladies and gentlemen, and the president's standing fast. He says they've been degraded and they're not effective and all the rest of it. And people are saying, you know, what are you thinking? Well, Americans are more concerned than ever that Islamic terrorists will try to slip into the United States. But President Obama isn't backing down from his plan to let 10,000 Syrian refugees into this country next year.
So now governors and members of Congress are trying to put that program on hold. They want to make sure that any refugees that come into this country don't pose a threat. Charlene Aron has the story.
Republican leaders in Congress are joining a majority of the nation's governors, trying to figure out how to stop more Syrian refugees from entering the country. New House Speaker Paul Ryan and Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell urged at least a temporary pause in the resettlement of Syrians, disputing claims that the small numbers making their way into the U.S. so far are being thoroughly investigated.
Our nation has always been welcoming, but we cannot let terrorists take advantage of our compassion. This is a moment where it's better to be safe than to be sorry. So we think the prudent, the responsible things take a pause in this particular aspect of this refugee program in order to verify that terrorists are not trying to infiltrate the refugee population.
With many Americans on edge after the Paris attacks, several lawmakers have already proposed legislation to restrict or block refugees from resettling in the U.S.
We have sleeper cells pervasive throughout the country in every state. Very difficult and challenging for the FBI to follow them in our Homeland Security. So we must be recognizing that we have a security issue right here.
More than 30 governors opposed the Obama administration's plan to allow 10,000 refugees from Syria to enter next year. The White House defends the program that vets the refugees, but critics question if it can really get the job done. Congressman Robert Pittenger told CBN News he believes governors should have the final say and not the president.
He is not a monarch, and he needs to work with our Congress, and the Congress, of course, wants to work with the governors. They'll be the ones who are responsible.
Senator Charles Schumer of New York, the third-ranking Democrat in the Senate, broke with most in his party, saying a pause in accepting Syrian refugees may be necessary. Meanwhile, Christian relief agencies say it's important that the church not let fear hinder sharing the gospel with the refugees.
It's something that doesn't have to be polarized as either safe or compassionate. We can be safe as well as we reach out to those communities and welcome Syrian refugees.
Meanwhile, author Johnny Moore agrees that the vetting process needs to be scrutinized more thoroughly.
Every single member of ISIS is a Muslim, and so it is a fact that we need to be more scrutinizing against Syrian refugees. And so I think the solution is both ends. You press pause, you make sure that our vetting process is sufficient, and in the meantime, we provide special treatment to those who clearly aren't members of ISIS.
Charlene Aron, CBN News.
Thanks, Charlene. My heart goes out to those people. You know, Bashar al-Assad, his mismanagement of Syria has resulted in that humanitarian disaster. And the fact that our president hasn't moved aggressively as he should have to take leadership there is another problem. And now the radicals with ISIS have moved into that void. Well, in other news, radical Islamic terrorism is still a major threat in France. A female suicide bomber blew herself up in Paris today as police closed in on her hideout. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
Thanks, Pat. Police were storming the woman's apartment when she detonated her explosive suicide vest. The raid today in the Parisian suburb of Saint-Denis lasted 7 hours as police closed in on an apartment where they believe more than a dozen ISIS operatives were hiding. At least two people were killed, including the woman, and at least seven more were arrested. Police were met with unexpectedly violent resistance as they closed in on the building. They thought the mastermind of last Friday's attacks might be inside. Well, Parisians have been starting to move on with their lives after the attacks, although that, of course, has been difficult. But as Abigail Robertson reports from Paris, Christians are there to help those mourning find hope in a time of crisis.
An ongoing manhunt, overnight raids, and intelligence reports saying European governments might have flagged Friday's terrorists well before the attacks. Yet despite all of this, Parisians are doing their best to move forward and return to their normal routines. But the mood in many offices is just not the same.
We have the TV channels everywhere, and we are looking and looking and looking, just staring at the TV.
The people of Paris are trying to move forward, but now that they know the attackers were born and raised in France and Belgium, many around the country wonder, is it safe moving forward?
They are here, and maybe this guy, we don't know. I'm afraid because now it's real.
French Christians are heading to the memorials to help comfort those grieving, as well as French-speaking chaplains from the Billy Graham Rapid Response Team.
Our goal is really to just bring hope in time of crisis.
The three national days of mourning have come to an end, but the people of Paris are hardly done healing. The Billy Graham Rapid Response Team has deployed 8 chaplains to the city to spread God's love and minister to the people during this difficult time.
I'm just standing with people. Just listening to them, praying with them if the opportunity is there, but also standing with the local church and encouraging the local church to respond.
Au service de l'église.
The chaplains will be here for at least 2 weeks praying with people and helping churches plan vigils like this one to reach out to the community during these challenging times.
People are responding to this Pray for Paris initiative. And so what we want to do is we want to encourage the church to take advantage of that and to create maybe prayer vigils, to maybe come and pray at the sites of the different shootings, and we will stand alongside and ready to minister to people alongside the church.
Wearing these shirts, I invite people to say, okay, we can pray together. It's simple.
The team asks for prayer that God will lead them to people with open hearts and that they will find spirit-led opportunities to minister to people ready and willing to hear the message of hope Jesus offers them. Reporting from Paris, Abigail Robertson, CBN News.
Thanks, Abigail. Well, here at home, Republican presidential candidate John Kasich says he would set up an agency to champion Judeo-Christian values overseas to counter propaganda from Islamists. Kasich says the agency would promote the values of human rights, democracy, and the freedoms of speech and religion with a focus on the Middle East, China, Iran, and Russia. He believes the U.S. is failing to advance American values in the battle of ideas. And as a reminder, Pat will be interviewing Governor Kasich today at Regent University. You can see highlights of that conversation on Thursday's 700 Club. And on Friday, Kentucky Senator Rand Paul will also be on the 700 Club as part of our series of interviews with the presidential candidates. Pat?
I think it's going to be exciting. I'm excited. We had a wonderful meeting with Jeb Bush a few weeks ago, John Kasich today, and then I think the Donald's going to be stopping by along with Cruz and Rubio. So we'll have a number of the candidates and give you a chance to hear what they believe. But I think it'll be fun. I'm looking forward to, I've known John Kasich for many, many years, and I think you'll find this a very enlightening discussion. And it will be on the 700 Club tomorrow, and I think we'll be streaming it out of the theater at Regent University today. John.
Thanks, Pat. Religious liberty has been playing prominently in the Republican presidential primary among many of the candidates, including at a recent event in the key early state of South Carolina. Paul Strand was there and brings us the story.
This weekend saw both Ben Carson and Ted Cruz descend on the Palmetto State, as so many presidential hopefuls have recently.
There's a reason candidates come early and often to South Carolina. It's the first primary in the South. It has 50 delegates to award. And as a part of the Bible Belt, it's particularly good ground for conservative Christian candidates.
Carson was attending a town hall with Senator Tim Scott, who wanted to make a point about racial progress in the South by having it at Bob Jones University, which used to actively practice racial discrimination.
Bob Jones University, like all of us, we've all had to evolve. And I am so proud of the progress that's happened here at BJU, and frankly, that's happened all across South Carolina.
A reporter wondered if Ben Carson worried he'll lose black votes because he was speaking at Bob Jones.
I'm not a politician, so I don't go around with my finger in the air saying, let's see, can I do that? And will that hurt me with this group? And will this hurt me with that group? That's what politicians do. I'm not a politician.
Betty Gregory said she felt pride rise within her at the town hall.
There was Dr. Carson, who came from the hood, you know, and there he is running for the president of the United States.
Next day at Bob Jones, the topic was religious liberty, as Senator Ted Cruz led and others rallied against religious persecution.
Many folks in the media belittle the threat to religious liberty, suggest it's not real, it doesn't exist. The purpose of these conferences is to put a face to put a human face, a human story on these threats so people understand they are real and they are growing.
A number of folks attacked for their faith gathered on the stage. Football coach Joe Kennedy has been suspended for praying on the 50-yard line after games. School administrators told him,
"It's your right as an American to pray, but we don't want anybody to see you doing it. We want you to go and hide. Like, I should be ashamed of what, you know, my beliefs are and who I am as an American."
The Old Guards of Iowa lost their business for refusing gay weddings and have faced a flood of hateful accusations.
Overnight, we became the most hateful, bigoted, racist, and words I can't even use. It was shocking. It was devastating, and it was hard to live through.
Tony Perkins of the Family Research Council called these attacks the new McCarthyism, which asks,
"Have you ever held the position that marriage should be the union of a man and a woman? And if so, you are driven from your job, you're alienated, you're marginalized, and you're treated as if you're some kind of throwback."
A reporter asked Senator Cruz if it's just Christianity under threat in America.
The Obama administration has demonstrated a particular antipathy for Christians. Christians are under assault from this administration. President Obama is fond of using the phrase freedom to worship. That, by the way, is not what the First Amendment says. What he means by that when President Obama says freedom to worship is that you can go between 11 a.m. and 12 on Sunday in your church service and say whatever you want, but at 12:01 when you walk out those doors, you have no right to live according to your faith.
Being right here in the middle of the Bible Belt, South Carolinians are as worried as any other Americans about the threats to religious liberty these days, which was a good reason to have a rally on that very subject right here in the Palmetto State. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from Greenville, South Carolina.
And Pat, we're just 94 days away until that primary in South Carolina.
Well, that's the key first primary, and I must say that I traveled when I was running for president. I traveled all over South Carolina. I had a bus. I actually went down to the low country, and they said, "You're the first candidate since George Washington to come here." So I let them know that I cared. But a guy named Lee Atwater, who was George Bush's man, had locked up South Carolina, and it wasn't going to come loose for me. So I think I ran third in the state. But it is going to be a key, and I think somebody that is able to score well in this coming primary in South Carolina will have a leg up all over the South. So it's a very important primary, more so in my opinion than Iowa, and more so really than New Hampshire.
But when you ran, you won in Iowa, right?
Oh yeah. Well, I beat Bush. I was second, but the newspaper headlines, it was Robertson beats Bush, and you know, Bob Dole won the state, but he didn't get any credit for it. But when I got to South Carolina, I ran third because I had two really tough opponents. But in any event, I think it'll be wide open. But I don't know how it's going to turn out. But it's a key primary.